also just, well, thank you all for coming today. I appreciate it. And we're going to have a really interesting talk today. Bob Briggs is here with us to tell us all about the carnation industry. He got his bachelor's degree from our department in 1959 and his master's in 61. And just a few weeks ago, we recognized him with one of the first alumni awards from our department. So we're really fortunate to have him here with us, and I will get out of the way so you can do your thing.
Good afternoon. How are you all today?
Good.
What part of the world do we have students from? How many are from Colorado? What part of Colorado?
Southern.
Southern, is that anything south of here, or is it south of Denver, or is it
it's
south
like
of
the San Luis Valley?
Okay. We were just down there last week, and that's a great place. Where are you from?
Denver.
Denver. Some in the back. Where are you from?
I'm from right here.
Okay.
Whoa.
Okay, now we got the Colorado people represented. Where's the rest of you from?
Texas.
Texas. Great place.
Upstate New York.
Upstate New York. That's good.
Greece.
Who?
Greece.
Okay, that's good too.
Northeastern Maryland.
Good.
North Carolina.
Well, all of those are good. How close do you come to being a part of Texas in Fort Collins? Was Fort Collins ever a part of Texas? Well, it turns out that prior to 1845, Texas had their state go all the way up to Casper. And it went from the Front Range over through the central Rocky Mountains. And lo and behold, you all, as Fort Collins, were a part of the great state of Texas at one point in your previous career. The thing that you probably need to know is what caused the boundary of Texas to end where it does today? What act in Congress made that happen that way? You probably have all studied it, you just didn't relate it. And it was the Missouri Compromise. And if they were going to bring Texas into the United States in 1845, the Missouri Compromise was a part of the compromise to allow Texas to come in the United States, and that's where they drew the boundary. They said no slave state could come in if it was above the Texas boundary at that point. And that's how the panhandle of Oklahoma got created, and the rest, they say, is history. How many of you have seen, and I'll pass a couple of these out. You can start one going that way, and I'll start one going over here. How many of you have seen this logo? That logo is the first perishable product to be registered as a trademark product in the United States. And that's the logo it had on it. The importance of a logo is simply that if it's not labeled, it's a commodity. And if you're going to have it something that you can promote and advertise, you need to label it. And that's why the labeling of the carnation was a very critical part. It was the Colorado Carnation. And the Colorado Carnation laid the foundation, in my opinion, for the horticulture research that has taken place on this campus and the far-reaching evolution it has made. And so that's what I want to talk about today, is the evolution of the Colorado Carnation and how it has impacted where you're at today, and just to have an understanding, because today nobody knows anything about it because we don't have any carnations grown in Colorado. So all of these, I'm going to give each of you one of those with a logo so you can pin it on And all of those came from South America because there isn't any grown in the state of Colorado today. So that's what I want to talk about. Now let's see if I make it work. I like it when it works. This is the Colorado Carnation. That's the seal that you see on the carnation. When we were grading the carnations back in those days, we would put four of those on a bunch of 25. And they just go on, you put it around the stem and push it together. If you do that, it doesn't come off. And so I hope that none of you pushed it together. But yeah, that's the way it goes. This is what the seal looks like. You've seen it up close and personal. Front and back. When you push that back in, it spreads out and goes into the upper level and makes the seal as it goes. It's a carnation, in my humble opinion, is a very pretty flower. When I started up here in the fall of 55, you know, my goal was to figure out how to raise those. And today, if you all started, you wouldn't have that same goal. Why Colorado? Well, if you've been here for a while, and for all those who are not native to Colorado, you know that there's a lot of sunshine. And you know that carnations like high amount of light. The day and night temperature, though, actually is a critical part because we get as much light as the desert states, but the day temperature is not hot. It's usually something less than 80. And if you're growing plants, the upper temperature is right around 80 where a plant will slow down and quit growing. And so if you're going to keep that plant growing, you have to have a lower day temperature and a lower night temperature. Carnations like a 52 degree night temperature. And so we get that normally 365 days a year. The eastern states, while they were close to the population centers, had high humidity and high night temperature, and they got 30, with the humidity and the rain came together, had 30 inches of rainfall a year. And the other magical thing that they had is the high cost of coal, is diesel oil that they were using. And it was a lot higher than our coal and later gas for us. In the 1920s, we had 40 growers, 5 wholesale shippers, $2 million in annual sales. And I've already told you about coal being cheaper. But we had a lot of diseases. And so that kept our production down. At that point, in carnation world, we measured everything in a square foot. And the production of carnations in the 1920s was 15 flowers per square foot. And we used trains to transport the carnations to the marketplace. Can't do that today. This was during the Great Depression, and one of the first things we did was organize a trade association. And it was called the Colorado Flower Growers Association. We joint purchased coal. When I was the exec for the Colorado Greenhouse Growers in the 1990s through 2004, we joint purchased gas. So, a different commodity, but you could joint purchase that heating thing that helped it make it cheaper. They did the first efforts to solve the disease issue, and the great thing that the industry did was they did education for the growers and all to help them grow a better crop. We even did monthly meetings. How many of you know the Oxford Hotel, which is a block south of the Union Station? That's where the industry met on a monthly basis. We would go, there's a room on the main floor, and that was our meeting room.
Speak a little louder.
You can't hear me? That's the first time that my wife has ever told me that she couldn't hear me. So I'll try to do a better job. I need to actually point out what she did for me. At the end of my sophomore year, I had a 1.62 grade point average, and a 1.60 would have kicked me out. And that's how close I was. But I got married, and I took genetics. And both of those were turning points. And so my bride back there has been with me for the 60 years since then to keep me on track and tell me if I'm not talking loud enough. How many of you have been in the Laurie Student Center? All of you, huh? Why was it named Laurie? It's a good question. He was the president of Colorado A&M in the 30s. And one of our growers, Homer Pearson, came to campus and said, we need research. And Laurie said, and I'm not sure of his exact words, but they were something like, you will have no cotton picking flower research on this campus. And on his way home, and you remember the cars in 1935 were pretty slow and the roads weren't anywhere close to what we've got today, so it took him 3 hours to get back to Wheat Ridge. During that trip, he said, who is his boss? And the what Homer decided was, his boss was the state legislature. And so Homer became the first state legislator from our industry. And one of the things that he evolved to, I remember this was the World War II, the Depression, World War II, and so Homer ended up being the Speaker of the House. And he ended up also being the President of the Senate, the only person that's held both of those positions. Today you can't do that, but in those days, because if you were the lieutenant governor, which he was at that point, he got to be the president of the Senate. And so the same person held both of those positions. And the story goes that Dr. Laurie came in and said, I want to do, and I don't know what it was he wanted to do, but Homer said, don't think so. And I don't know if he used those exact words or not. And Dr. Laurie left. He come back about an hour later, and there's only a couple of hats on. He took off his hat at that point and threw it in the office and said, yes, sir, we'll do it your way. And that's when Homer got his full revenge. And he helped fund then the greenhouse that was over here on Lake Street. And that's where it says that he had the research greenhouse, and then we trademarked the carnation at that point. This was the greenhouse. How many of you have seen that? All right. What does it look like today? That's where the new football stadium is at. And so if you go enjoy the football stadium, you my years was all spent doing the, I worked in those greenhouses for 30 to 40 hours a week all the time I was a student up here, and that helped pay for my education. When you cut carnations, you graded them into four grades. You had a long stem, and then this was in 24 inches. Next one was 21, and then the bottom one was 18. And that's one of the things you did, was you graded them. It was the size of the flower, the strength of the stem, all of those made for the grades that we had. The fancies and the standards is where we had put that seal on. This is my mother-in-law, and this is the device that we use to bunch all the carnations. And each of those points in here, that's the short one, the medium one, and the long stem. And so you'd put them in, grab the stems, and with a machete, cut them off. And if you kept your fingers out of the machete, it was no problem. If you left your finger in, then it was an issue. See, I still have all my fingers. And so that boiler is the boiler that we had in our grading. This is Professor Bob Holly. Bob was hired by, in 1949, by the industry. And the industry paid his salary for 5 years. Now, a couple things that you couldn't do today. One is you couldn't hire somebody and bring them up to campus and say, here's your new professor. The people on campus frown upon doing that today, right? And it took 5 years before they put him on the payroll, even at that. And the growers paid for his salary. It was Homer Pearson, when he was working at the State House, that finally got him on the payroll. But the important thing that Bob Holly and Tex Baker, and how many of you have heard the name Tex Baker? He was a botany professor, right? Tex and Bob worked real hard on the disease issues facing the carnation industry. And it was their efforts that took the production from 15 flowers a square foot to 55 flowers a square foot. And it was that combination of research that took place on this campus that made all the difference in the world. During that period of time, greenhouses become air conditioned. You all look at a greenhouse today and there's all these fans hanging on the walls. That didn't exist until the mid-1960s. And so a red carnation in a non-air conditioned greenhouse would burn up because it would absorb the heat. And so you virtually didn't have any reds during the summer, spring and summer, because it was too hot for the greenhouses. And all this greenhouse was paid for by the growers. I already mentioned the 15 flowers a square foot. If you use stem culture, and I've heard people say that they still use that. That original technology was developed for the disease-free aspects of carnations. Today, all the orchids that are produced around, maybe not all of them, but the bulk of them, use that technology so that you get a nice, clean, young plant that will grow well. The injection of carbon dioxide, if you go around the countryside, all this new crop that they're growing, it's called M, what's that next initial? J? Marijuana. All of those growers use an injection of carbon dioxide. And it works, but that research was originally paid for by the Carnation Brothers. The other one was, it was the first injection, fertilizer injection system used in agriculture. Today, if you go to those pivots that they have in the field, they're injecting fertilizer through those now. And it all started in the greenhouse industry and temperature controls. Wadsworth Controls. Wadsworth Controls started as an electrician installing the first greenhouse controls for air conditioning, and his whole business evolved out of that. Bob Holly also started Pan American Seed, and Pan American Seed was one of the largest seed companies in the world, and it was started with three guys. All three were students at Michigan State. So you got to be careful who you go to school with, because it might evolve into a very high-powered business like Bob did with the Pan American Seed. But one came from Peonia, and one was in San Jose down in and they did a great job with Pan American Seed. Pan American Seed now is owned by Ball Seed Company. Bob sold a lot of cut flowers. My favorite cut flower story, why we didn't sell them, we gave them to them, was when Mrs. Morgan called. And I had to answer the phone, and she said, "Bob, this is Mrs. Morgan, and we need some flowers." And so we would wrap up some flowers, and we wrapped them up real fancy, Denver Post, and take them over to the administration office. And that's the way you kept the skids greased, so that you didn't have administration coming at you. And so that was worthwhile. But we did a lot of that kind of promotion for our Carnation. Now, Steve, are you have a Carnation book back there?
Everybody in the room.
Everybody in the room gets one of these books. Bob wrote the two of those books. He was inducted into the Society of American Florists Hall of Fame and the Colorado Floriculture Hall of Fame. And he had many students that, like me, contributed a lot to the industry. And it's those kinds of things that makes a difference. When you get out with your degree, you'll automatically become a leader in the industry. And you'll have the opportunity to do a lot of great things. And so that's the important aspect of what your education can do for you. This was the Aspen pad. That was the first rendition of the cooling that we did. Now, they've done away with Aspen pads today. It's some cardboard stuff. But the Aspen pad was interesting in that it shed. And there was a pit similar to what you have today in the center. And it would suck the water out and put over the pads. Well, when the aspen shedding came down and filled up the device that the pump was sucking water out of, it quit sucking water. And so we would have to, as part of the responsibility of keeping the pads working, go in and pull that aspen pad, clean it off, that suck. The other thing we did, because you're pulling that 10-mile-an-hour wind through that greenhouse, you're pulling in all the bugs. Well, we would put malathion or diathion or parathion in that water. And we, of course, did all the things that you do today, you know, cover up, all those things. You know we did that, right? Doesn't bother you much every once in a while when you get to use. Today we look back at what we did, understanding that all of those would kill you if you allowed it to, But we didn't know that. And so you got an advantage today as you know that. And so hopefully you won't do what we did for all those years. This was the fans on the other end. The fans look different today. Today they have them set on an angle and bigger blades and all of those types of things. But this was the first, in the 60s, the first fans that went on the greenhouse. You can see there what the carnations look like. The reason that a steam heat was important for a greenhouse was it would keep it warm, but two, it would allow you to sterilize your soil that's in your benches. And when we had that bench, this scene, we'd cover that bench with plastic, run a tube down the center, run the steam into that tube, and you could heat that bench up 120, 130. I like to think I could even get hotter than that, but in reality, we really couldn't. And once you uncovered that, if you caught anybody touching that soil with anything but gloves or something else on, you would give them a rough time because you would steam sterilize. And that's the reason that we were able to reduce the Fusarium oxysporum and the Fusarium roseum from those soils, because we could steam sterilize. And this type of equipment allowed us to do that. This was our fertilizer injector. It was a 5-gallon or 50-gallon drum, and we'd mix the fertilizer in the top one, let it settle, and then drain it into the bottom when you were out, and you just kept going. And it worked very well. We fertilized every time we water. Today, your fertilizer injector looks a lot different now, but this was the pioneer. 1967. Nearly 120 million blooms were produced in the Denver area by 148 growers. Nearly $10 million with an average value of nearly 12 cents. Now, you say that isn't a very impressive number, but that was 1967. What was the value of wheat in 1967? Wheat in the state of Colorado for the whole state. It was less than this. We produced more value in Colorado than the wheat people did. California produced twice as many, 2.5 times more than we did, and they sold each of their blooms for less than a nickel. That's why it pays to label, because that labeling allows us to promote what we were doing and that it was better, and so we get twice the value out of it. We sold in all 50 states, Canada and Mexico. How many recognize the initials DWF? What does it stand for?
Denver Wholesale Florist.
Denver Wholesale Florist. In 1967, how many growers did they have?
148.
No, they didn't have all of them. There was five growers, or five wholesalers. But they had somewhere 80 or 90. They were the largest wholesaler in Colorado. How many growers do you think they have today? Who owns DWF? Who is their biggest shareholder in 1967 that ended up buying all the rest of those growers' shares out? Starts with a T. Next letter is A. Next one is G. Tagawa. Tagawa owns 100% of DWF today because they just kept buying out when everybody else was selling. By the way, Ken DeGallo and I were in high school together. Ken was in my wife's class at Westminster High School in 1956. Denver Wholesale sold 500,000 green carnations in 1967. Now, you understand that in order to get green carnations, you had to have white ones. They had not to be put in water, because once you get them in water, you can't reactivate the water going up. But the way you tell when you're looking at a carnation whether or not it's tinted is you look at the veins, because it's the vein in the flower that turns color. And so a green carnation will have white around with a green vein. Blue, same, yellow, same. And that's the way you tell the difference. And you can only tint flowers if the carnation has never been in water, and you put them in with whatever color you have, and it turns them that color. The growers paid 2% of their gross sales. So 1% for the research that was done up here. When I did my master's work, I had a grower-supported stipend, so I could, for the first time, get paid for what I was thinking about doing and doing. And they did that kind of thing. They provided a lot of dollars for research. I don't know that there's anybody giving any research dollars today, but we did up through the mid-2000s because of that. And then the other 1% went to promotion. When I was president of the Colorado Flower Growers Association in 1969, this was the book that we published. And I unfortunately don't have enough that I can give to everybody. But I'll pass it around. It has all the ways to handle a carnation. And so that is one of the promotion things that we did. And if you were the president of CSU, you got flowers, but we didn't label the flowers that we sent over to the president. But if you were the governor or the president of the United States, you got labeled flowers. What year was that Ford?
42.
I don't know how old it was. All I know was when I got into it and dropped the clutch, it would squeal.
It was 49. It has flat windshield.
Huh?
It's flat windshield. It's got 49.
Yeah. These were the greenhouses that I built to do the research on fiberglass. And the important thing to you all is that if the white fiberglass produced 10% more flowers than the glass house did, and the pink was 5%, if that pink had been anywhere close to 10%, you all would be raising flowers or plants in a pink carnation or a pink greenhouse. That's how close you came to having a pink one.
Why pink?
Well, in those days, we didn't understand that there's value in a different color. What we did was we run a research that had 8 colors. And the 2 best of those was the pink and the white. Well, I got a souvenir on this wrist. When I changed the air conditioning in that house, when I was a graduate student, I did everything right. You know, I followed all the directions except one. And that's that you're, when you're using a knife, you're not supposed to reach above your cut and come this way. You're supposed to work at, well, I did that, and I stabbed myself. And the guy that took me to the hospital was a guy by the name of Larry Watson. So we're in the emergency room, and the gal that was waiting on me heard a commotion out in the hallway. So she went out to find out what the issue was. It was Larry laying on the ground. He passed out. And I give him a rough time about that every time I see him. He got more attention than I did. This was me when I had a crew cut. And Phylon Fiberglass is the one who donated the fiberglass for this. Their sales took off because they were able to prove that Phylon did a good job of growing plants. This was the first aluminum frame and Phylon covered fiberglass greenhouse in the world. And it was located at 68th and Pecos. And guess who owned it? That was our research project that we put together. And it worked pretty good. That's a 15,000 square foot greenhouse. 1970, we then were up to 150 greenhouses. We had over 8 million square feet. We had 10,000 employees. Carnations are very labor intensive. They take an employee per 8,000 square feet. We had over 20 million in sales. Again, we shipped to Canada, Mexico, and all 50 states. And at this point, we were shipping by air because the jet engine had come in. And so the Colorado carnation industry for the decade of mid-60s to mid-70s was the number one shipper on United and Continental Airlines. What happened? Well, this president, his initials was LBJ. He was fighting a drug war. And you'd say, well, I don't know that he was very successful because it's worse today than it was then. Right? But he thought there was another alternative. His alternative was to give the growers of the white stuff, the cocaine, in Colombia a different crop. And he did that. He did three things. He sent the money to build the greenhouse. He sent the greenhouse technology. And then he gave them one minor thing that ultimately put us out of business. And that is what is called favored nation status. Today, if you import in the United States sweaters or shoes or hats or whatever, if you create an undue advantage because you can do it cheaper, they put a tariff on you. With favored nation status, you don't get that tariff. And then for the next 20 years, we had all the flowers coming in the United States. They shipped over 80% of the production to Holland to run through the auctions. But what they dumped was the rest of it in the United States for the price of the box. All of the cut flower holidays in the United States are heating holidays for us. You know, Christmas, Valentine's, Easter, Mother's Day, Memorial Day. You can't grow a flower that any of those kinds of year without heating your greenhouse. If you go to the other side of the equator, it's their summer, it's our winter, and they have no heating cost. Their labor cost was about 20% of ours. And so they had a lot of flexibility in their crop. And that's what put us out of business. I got to tell you one other quick story. If you get down to the airport, in Miami. There's five buildings on that airport that are big buildings, fancy buildings. You know what they do for a living? They import cut flowers. And they sell them for the price of the box. Now, if you understand that, you know that there isn't a lot of leftover money off of that, but they're building monuments because there is some other cash flow in those boxes that are coming up on jet planes from South America. So, today, no cut flowers are produced in the United States except outside. No carnations are produced in Colorado. The Colorado trademark went away in 1985, but the greenhouse industry has reinvented itself. So I'm at a point that I can answer questions. Any questions? Yes?
What was the competition like with California? So I remember that California was selling them fairly much cheaper than we were able to sell them in Colorado. Did that change over time, or was it always California was cheaper than Colorado?
Well, California has decided today to put a logo on their cut flowers. Mm-hmm. They it took them a while to understand that if you don't put a logo on it, you're just a commodity. And so we were able to, we visited California growers, and they came to visit us to share information. But, no, they're... The Kittyamas, I don't know if any of you have heard of the Kittyamas, they built a big greenhouse north of Brighton. And they came just so that they could label some of their production as a Colorado production.
And get that premium price.
And get that premium price.
Also, did you ever, did the industry ever try growing other flowers besides carnations, or were carnations really the moneymaker?
We, up until the mid-80s, it was strictly carnation. Alstroemeria has the same temperature requirement as carnations. And so there was some of that tried to grow, but it never really caught on, because whatever you produce, you have to sell. And the wholesalers were acclimatized to taking 100% of their product from the growers. When we opened in 1973 a retail store, one of the things we started doing 2 years before that was selling our shorts and designs out the front door. I was only getting something like 3 or 4 cents per stem for those, and I could sell them for 10. And so we sold our shorts and designs for $1.29 a dozen, and there was a couple holidays we sold right at 20,000 cut flowers, which is a pretty good record those days. But what we found once we started selling on a retail basis, that our customer coming in saying, "I would like," and it wasn't always the carnation. They'd buy those, but they wanted bedding plants and those types of things, and that's when we started making the transition to bedding plants and green plants. Terrariums, for example, in that period of time was a tremendous thing that we could grow. In the fall of 1973, Albertsons gave us an order for a couple thousand or so terrariums. And we put them together, delivered them to the Albertsons up and down the Front Range, and that helped us pay the gas bill over that winter so we could survive. One of the other aspects of that, in 1973, we had an acre of greenhouse. That acre of greenhouse cost us $5,000 a heap. 1978, that same acre of greenhouse cost us $28,000. Dollars a heap. Today, that heat cost is pushing $120,000 a heap. And so, If you're going to have a crop in a Colorado greenhouse, you got to have something that will produce enough revenue to at least pay that bill. And if you don't pay just that bill, you can't pay for labor and you can't do the other things you need to do. Other questions? Yes, sir.
There seems to be an increasing interest in local production for food, right? So local fruits and vegetables and so forth. Do you think there's a market for labeling it local flowers? So coming up with the Colorado carnation, do you think people would pay a premium for that?
If you don't have to pay for heat, and your heat cost is your biggest single cost, if you got to pay for heat, it's going to be tough to reintroduce it. I think the technology exists that we might be able to come around that. But there's a lot of opportunities. I think local foods is one that will ultimately allow us to come back and be a part of the industry again. But the bedding plants is still going. Why can't they bring a bedding plant into Colorado that has soil on it?
Diseases.
There's diseases that come in with that soil. And one of the things that happens is, if you bring in your suitcase a plant with soil on it, it will go into confinement and be there for 2 or 3 weeks. And that's because they want to check it for diseases. And that's one of the things that, until that, we still have, from the bedding plant industry, an opportunity to grow some of those plants. Other questions? Yes?
I just wanted to know, when you look at a carnation, what are you looking for? What makes a good carnation, in your opinion?
You have to have a stem that stands out like that.
Like a long, strong stem.
It can't have an arc to it. It needs to be strong. You need to, when you look at it, you need to have petals all throughout this. The calyx can't be split. And so if that's split, that means that there was a drop of 10 degrees or more in less than a half an hour. And now split calyxes all lay. And so that's the kind. This is what we call a first crop carnation. The second crop, when you grow it, don't have that strong a stem. Now, if you were in the old days, you pick up a red or a pink, there would be a spot of red in the pink and white. There would be a spot of white in the red. That was what they called SIM varieties. And that's the way all the research that we did was on the SIM varieties. There are not any SIM varieties grown today. All right, other questions?
I read a little bit about people counterfeiting Colorado carnations. I was wondering what that was like and what you did about that.
Well, if they counterfeited anything, they counterfeited the
logo. Yeah, that's the tags.
We had retailers that would cut them off because they didn't want to, they thought it distracted from their going. If they were going to go to all that extent, it's like anything else today. You can counterfeit most anything you do. So I never heard that much about it. But as I understand it, the bell rings at one and you all get up and run. Is that the way it goes?
It goes.
Again, I want to leave you two things. One, I very much enjoyed my 6 years on this campus. It was allowed me to go from, I was tongue-tied and stuttered, and it allowed me to go from that to what I do today. And I couldn't have got up and talked to a group of people because because I was scared to death of doing that. And so that was an important part to me. The second was, when you got that degree, it opens up doors. And I've had a lot of doors open because I have that Hort degree. And so it's an important degree. Horticulture is the fastest growing segment of agriculture in the United States. And so you're in the right field. You just have to decide that there's some ups and downs, but there's ups and downs in everything you do. And so that's part of it. And then again, I want to say thanks to my bride, because it's her efforts. When we did the greenhouses and we did the trade association work and all of that, she was the one that was right beside me helping to make sure I got it all squared away. Well, let's give her now another round of applause. I have some books up here, and I have a carnation, and I have a label. So all of you get, you can come up and look at the books, and you can get a carnation and grab a label and put it on. Thank you very much.